Hey, thanks for coming under the blanket fort. Set up in the corner of apartment 16Q, next to the radiator, behind the futon, and using the blankets that we found when we first moved in. Not really sure we should be using those.
So then I actually went and I got in line, got a coffee. It was great. I needed a coffee. I don't drink coffee. Okay. I desperately needed a coffee, and that was it.
And you're telling me a story about why you needed coffee.
Yeah.
Guys. I just found the coolest thing ever. Okay. It's one of the last episodes of The Honeymooners.
For real?
Yeah. I brought my iPad under the blanket fort if you guys want to watch it.
Can we watch?
Can we watch it? For real?
Let's watch it.
Jackie Gleason, The Honeymooners, with the stars Art Carney, Audrey Meadows, and Joyce Randolph.
Oh, Trixie, thank goodness. Come in quick. I can't find Ralphina. Alice, dear, how do you lose a 9-month-old baby in this little apartment? I don't know. I haven't been able to think straight lately, I guess. Well, no wonder. Your face is all black and blue. Oh, sure. You know how Ralph has been threatening. One of these days, Alice. One of these days. Pow! Right in the kisser. 15 years later, he finally decides to follow through. Look at you, honey. You're all bandaged up and your arms in a sling. If he finds out Ralphina's missing, he is gonna clobber you to death. Oh, dear. You're right. Let's think. If I were a baby, where would I crawl to? Oh, maybe under the tablecloth. Well, I'll look. You shouldn't bend down with those busted ribs. Wait a minute. What's this? My wedding ring. Oh, for crying out loud. Ralph broke my ribs for nothing. Honey, you're lucky it didn't get sucked up into the vacuum cleaner. You know, you're right, Trixie. That thing can suck harder than the baby on my nip when I haven't fed her in 3 hours. We need to find her so Ralph doesn't slaughter you. Have you checked the closets? Yes, dear. I've looked everywhere. But I can't see too well with these shiners. My eyes are more swelled up than my labia was after giving birth to the baby. Oh, a skeleton? That scared the living daylights out of me. It's nearly Thanksgiving. Why on earth do you have a Halloween decoration in your closet? That looks like my mother's dress. Oh my, that is my mother! Oh, Ralph is gonna flip his lid. I'm pulling her body out of this closet. Poor thing. Oh, look, my mother was holding his bowling ball all along. He'll be so happy we found
it. Your mother is dead, and you're worried about Ralph's bowling ball?
I found his ball. Maybe he'll stop beating me. You know, I'd like to pop Ralph in the head beating you to a pulp like that. Oh, Trix, he's not all bad. At least he bought me this Hoover. Speaking of, I'd better dump this vacuum cleaner bag before Ralph gets home. What was that? Another bowling ball? Oh, no! It's the baby! I must have vacuumed her up. Oh, honey.
Holy shit!
Good lord! But you know what the funniest part is, you guys?
Oh, God.
I heard that in the actual original story, the baby dies.
Oh my god, that's so much worse.
The lost episode? Mm-hmm. Like, Jesus.
They had to cut that and make the baby live. It was too dark, but then they realized,
yeah.
I don't think we can really air this episode. It's 1953.
Jackie Gleason is a monster. Oh my god.
Good lord. They're so just casual about spousal abuse.
They were. Oh my god. You would not catch a shit on like an old Superman.
No.
Ever. I mean, he barely punched anybody in that show.
He gave them, he would give villains a stern talking to.
Yeah.
And then tell them to eat, like, maybe a bowl of Kellogg's cereal and then join the Boy Scouts or something.
Yeah, it really would.
That's what he would do.
Learn to tie your knots, kids.
Yeah.
Did you guys ever notice, though, that, like, no one noticed that Clark Kent and Superman were the same people?
You know, he just put on glasses. That was his deal.
Glasses and parted his hair differently, actually. That's all it was.
Did he?
Yeah. If you watch the Christopher Reeves movies, there's one, he's coming out of an alley and he's ripping his shirt off and rips his glasses off and he goes in as Clark Kent. As he comes out, his hair is parted a different way. And it's not a continuity thing, Superman. It's a weird thing, man. I've read this. It's something about like the direction you part your hair has a personality thing. Am I the only one
you
that
guys,
knows this?
Stop. It's getting hot under this blanket fort. Okay.
Yeah, talking about parting hair. My God.
God damn it, people.
I'm a little turned on.
Fuck you all.
Christopher Reeve, you know, parting his hair.
Just to get you all hot and bothered.
There's just nothing hotter.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I was picturing
you know what's really, you know what's really hot? Christopher Reeve's parting his hair riding a horse.
Oh, no,
come on. That was...
Faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound. Up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman!
Today's episode of the Superman Radio Show is brought to you by Rum Chata. Rum Chata, because Bailey's can put on its finest evening wear and go fuck itself. And now, today's episode, Superman Saves the Orphanage! We find mild-mannered Clark Kent on his way to his job at the Daily Planet.
Ah, the bracing winds of autumn. A mighty thanks to you, planet Earth.
Oh no, the hospital!
This sounds like a job for my alter ego, Superman.
Oh god, here he goes again.
Now to find a trusty phone booth. Sweet molasses, where do they put all the phone booths? Ah, over there!
Yeah, this one's occupied, Superman. Head over a couple of blocks.
Superman? Ha ha! I wish. I'm just Clark Kent. I need to make a call. About news.
Hey, whatever, Supes. But you better hurry. Those fires. Yes, so I told you.
No, friend. I'm not Superman. I'm just a reporter, and I'd like to make a...
For shit's sake, Superman. Just walk in there and save those kids. I mean, we all know it's you. Just have to.
Jehoshaphat! Who designed this building? I just need to change.
Hello there, Superman. I don't want to be a bother and tell you how to do your job, but...
For the last time, I'm not Superman.
Listen, you've been really cool with the whole pretending you aren't Superman thing, but now's really not the time.
Clark, you have to get Superman here.
Seriously, you haven't told her. Oh, sweetie, no.
Well, you see,
Tell me what, Clark?
It's not important. What is important is that I get to a... Shit.
Yeah, I'm gonna go root for Lex Luthor now.
Tune in next week to hear Superman goose a Nazi.
Ah, mein scheiße Haus.
And enjoy a bowl of Hank's old-time shredded bran meal.
My, this was a fantastically bland bowl of cereal. Now I have the energy to fight crime? Bathroom. Now.
So I'm getting on the elevator, right? And, you know, I make small talk because it's like a social experiment for me. Like, will you follow through?
Mm-hmm.
This was like last week. This was Friday. And I said to the guy, hey, man, Friday, right? Because we're going to work. It's like early in the morning. Like, hey, man, Friday, right? And he goes, yeah, right. And he's like so depressed. I'm like, weekend, am I right? And he looks at me so depressed. He goes,
just means Monday's coming.
Oh,
I was like, holy shit! Oh, that hurt!
That is the definition of, like, a defeatist attitude.
Yeah, because
there is no joy in this man's life.
No, and, like, that's not sad. Even the promise of a Saturday. Like, even Saturday, even if you have the worst Monday, it's like, I got all Saturday and a Sunday coming.
Sundays, yeah, I can see, like, oh, Sunday, like, oh, I gotta go to work
tomorrow. Yeah.
Like, you kind of have that loop. You have 2 whole days.
Yeah, not only 2 days, you just gotta get through Friday. That's it. And then you're out.
Yeah.
This man was just so defeated. I was so depressed for the entirety of Friday.
It is just sadness incarnate.
Yeah. So I'm never talking to the guy from 7Q again. Ever.
Suck my balls.
I lived with you guys in this apartment 16Q.
Yeah. Because it's a terrible joke.
Yep. So I lived in my first neighborhood that I lived in Manhattan was Inwood, if you're familiar.
Yeah.
I lived right on the corner of Dyckman and Seaman. No joke. To get to my apartment, this is how I gave directions.
Oh, God.
So you're on the West Side Highway, right?
Right.
You're just riding along on the West Side Highway, and you get off on Dyckman. From Dyckman, you go down on Seaman, but if you get to Cumming, you've gone too far.
Stop, that's not real.
It's really true.
That's really?
That's really where I lived, yeah, right on the corner of Seaman and Dyckman. Let's talk about Christopher Reeve.
I thought we did that already.
Okay, well, anyway. So, if you're not familiar, there's a lot of Dominican people in that neighborhood. So I lived on the 5th floor of a walk-up, and my window faced Dyckman Avenue. So people would park on the street, usually, you know, somewhere between 11 p.m. and 2 a.m. Reasonable, right? Okay. And blast their music. So all of a sudden you hear this boom chicka boom chicka boom chicka boom chicka boom chicka boom bum 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 chicka boom.
Did you have John Philip Sousa just marching down the street? That was so peppy. I'm like energized.
So there's an elephant marching down the street and now there's clowns.
So I had a friend staying with me one time and she's like the sweetest person ever. Her name is Robin and she's like, you know, like smaller than me and very petite and cute and sweet and friendly and from Texas, and she talks like this. She's really cute. I call her Birdie. So she's staying over at my apartment. So, of course, we go to bed, not with each other. We go to sleep, I should say.
Right.
As soon as we decide to go to sleep around 11:30, bum 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 chicka bum chicka bum chicka bum chicka bum chicka bum chicka bum 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 bum. So.
That was a hillbilly jug band. That's what
that was. That's what it was.
That is a hillbilly jug band.
I'm trying
band
to play like that kind of, you know.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
I don't
about
know what you call that kind of music. What is it? Like
hip hop?
Salsa?
Merengue?
Merengue!
Bachata?
Merengue!
That might be racist.
I think that's what you're looking for.
Yeah, that's what I was looking for.
You guys, I'm half Spanish. It's okay.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really.
Oh, wow.
Okay, anyway. Okay, we're way off.
Yeah, wow, this is great. Yeah.
So I say to Robin, you know what I've been dying to do, but I've never had the guts to do it. I heard that if you throw eggs at the people, they will stop playing the music because you can't call the cops. The cops won't do anything. I've tried that. You can't yell at them or else, you know, like they could be violent. I don't know. So Robin and I, in our pajamas, get all the eggs out of the refrigerator. Go over to the window, sneak over, tiptoe, open up the window really quietly. We start throwing eggs at the guys playing the music. Yeah, nothing happened.
They didn't stop.
Yeah,
they didn't stop. I don't think we hit them, but it was just so fun because all of a sudden we felt like schoolgirls. We're like giggling and like, oh my god, they're gonna see us! Yeah.
Come on, Murphy. This guy's got nothing. Give him the heat. Fly it across his stupid nose. What? That boy Murphy showed his guys what kind of arm you got. Slap it home. Slap it home. You got him on the ropes, Murph. Just another seamer across the plate and we got this jamoke. Oh, jeez, I'm growing a screaming hills of more. It caught me right in the balls. A baseball in my actual balls. Holy fine crack babies, that hurts.
Next up.
Oh, yeah, Murph. Send one of those this way. He won't.
Strap.
Oh, thank God. Oh, God. That's the way, Murphingham. Whoa. Okay. Howling kittens, that was close. Maybe he's up on the next. Christ on fire. What the hell was that about? Steaming bowl of soup was in the same spot. Oh, reading rainbow. I think one of them fell off.
Rip some dirt on it. Next up.
Laughing Lantern and Lazarus Murphy. Just walk him in. It ain't a disgrace. Everyone has a walk once in a... Murphy, please, for the love of Laura Prepon, just let it go. Let him have a base. Saying O'Malley eating the Cobb salad. Murphy, you motherbucket of sequel Cono. I'm in the box of ears as soon as I wake up.
Jesus.
No.
There's a chemist, an engineer, and a mathematician.
Okay.
And they're all at a conference, right? And they're they all go back to their separate rooms at the exact same time. And as it would just so happens, they have a spontaneous fire happen right in the middle of their room. So the chemist, he gets some baking soda and some vinegar and he pours it around it and, you know, goes out because there's no oxygen in there. And the engineer, he gets a blanket, soaks it in water, throws it on top of the fire. He takes a fire extinguisher, sprays it on top, and then he covers the whole thing in ice just to, you know, the whole thing. He's very thorough. The mathematician, though, he looks at the fire, stares at it for a couple seconds, you know, real quiet-like, and he goes in the bathroom, takes out a match, lights it, looks at it, and holds it underneath the running faucet. He says, aha! A solution exists. And then he goes to bed.
Get it? It's a joke about mathematicians.
Is it? That's hilarious, right? Isn't it great?
They all work in theoreticals. Not...
My dad's a mathematician.
Is he? He would love that joke.
He probably heard it a million times and maybe even wrote it himself.
Is your dad that old? Because I think it was like Stone Age.
Stone Age, yeah.
Fair. I got one. There's a farmer. Farmer's having, he's got cows, and his cows aren't producing milk. So what he does is he brings in a chemist, a biologist, and a physicist to help him kind of figure out what's wrong with these cows. So you know, chemist kind of looks at the problem and goes to the farmer and says, okay, here's the problem. So your soil doesn't have the right nutrients in it. So what you do is you take these chemicals, put it over your grass, the cows eat the grass, they get the nutrients, they produce the milk. Biologist is like, no, he's wrong. The problem is your cows aren't producing the right enzymes to produce milk. So what you need to do is feed your cows these little pills I'll give you, and they'll produce milk, and it'll be great. Fizz is like, nope, you're both wrong. But I know the solution here. Farmer's like, okay, well, what do I do? Physicist goes, okay, first assume a spherical frictionless cow.
Because that's how you start all the physics wrong.
Oh my goodness.
I think it snorts on mine.
Sorry.
Sirs wasn't
I'm
snort.
A snorter. What can I
but
say?
I didn't get a snort on mine. I'm really kind of offended.
I'm sorry.
Sorry, it wasn't that funny.
So I've been really baffled as to how people are able to cheat. Right? Cheating is just something I can't understand. Because it's wrong. It's amoral. So finally, the other day, I asked this guy, I was like, hey, dude, listen. How are you okay cheating on your wife? How do you not feel guilty about this, you know? And he says, oh, well, what she don't know won't hurt her. And I'm like, yeah, but it might give her HPV. And then he just stuck it back in. I also just recently found out that birth control's got a bunch of different uses. Did you know this?
Yeah.
I didn't know. This is like news to me. I had no idea. Because one of my girlfriends now, she takes it because it helps clear up her acne. And then another one takes it because it helps manage her cycle. I take it because I'm a hoe. So that's why I do it. I got my first bikini wax in the summer, which was painful. But I just got the sides done, only the sides, because it was summer. So, like, you know, if you're on the beach in your bikini, like, or in a pair of shorts, like, the public sees that, you know? But then I decided to wax the rest of my vagina, because the public sees that. So I just wanted to make sure that everything was smooth sailing. I'm doing all this stuff because my boyfriend just broke up with me recently. Yeah, which is rough, because I thought that everything was going so well. Like, we bickered about some things, you know, like him leaving the seat up after peeing, or me blowing his friends. So it was hard. It was difficult, but I feel like I've learned so much from the breakup. I feel like I've matured, you know, like I'm channeling my inner Sting. Like, what does he say? If you love somebody, set them
free.
On fire, right? On fire. I'm a bit hungover today. I am. Not gonna lie. I've been going out. I actually just got back from Amsterdam. Yeah, a month ago. So I'm still recovering. And it's a beautiful, beautiful place, Amsterdam. The only thing more beautiful than Amsterdam is the people who live there. Like, Dutch people are gorgeous. Everybody there is like tall, blonde, and skinny. Everybody looks like a model. And I'm not used to that. I'm from the Bronx, you know? Like, I'm not used to that homogenous, like, pasty Caucasian population. So it was funny because, you know, being from New York, I was seeing tall, blonde, white people doing shit over there they wouldn't be caught dead doing here, right? Like, for example, who do we have, like, bussing tables and washing dishes here in New York? Mexicans, right? Thank you, Tim. Mexicans. Tim is racist. No.
I knew it.
Yeah, but I was at a restaurant in the Netherlands, and I looked into the kitchen, and Thor was washing the dishes. It was pretty dope. Yeah, I like traveling. I'm big into that. I like the white boys. I like very pale, almost albino-looking guys. Right? Tim, Chris, Jake, you're in for it. Yeah, pasty's tasty. I like it. I like that shit. I like dudes who look like my dad. My dad is hot. Like, I don't know how to not like men who look exactly like my father. Like, my dad looks like Aaron Eckhart. Do you know Aaron Eckhart? He's Two-Face, Harvey Dent, and Batman. Have you seen him? Do you know him?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Right? Don't you just want to sit on his face? Do you not? And that's my dad's face. Like, it's the same face. He's really awkward for me. One thing I hate, though, I hate it when white guys date Asian girls. I don't like it. Which is, like, fine, to each their own. But I'm just jealous because there's no way that I can compete with Asian women, you know? They've got that straight, sort of really shiny, jet black hair, right? And my hair looks like I could harbor a family of sparrows in it. It's just, I understand their appeal, but we're just so different. You know, like, they're very coy. Very coy. Like, they're kind of, I like to call them crouching tiger hidden charisma, you know? Right? And they sort of, they're so shy that they wait around for dudes to sort of approach them, which I think is funny. Because I've got zero qualms about flagging down some random Belgians on the street and being like, hey, I don't have a gag reflex. So whatever you want to do with that information, so you just give me a call. I'm so slutty. I'm half Puerto Rican and half white. So I'm like West Side Story Part 2. growing up mixed was always interesting for me. For one thing, like, my family members and I, it was a sort of a strained relationship. You know what I mean? Like, I was just different, right? I was the only one who knew who her daddy was. Things like that. It was weird. I, like, couldn't communicate with them because, you know, my mom was incapable of teaching me the language. But my mother was born in Puerto Rico and raised in the South Bronx. So she is fluent in both English and Spanish. She just can't speak either of them. So I never know what she's talking about. And I didn't know what I was supposed to look like as a mixed kid, you know? Because in general, like, growing up, my dad's from the Upper East Side, you know? So it's all just white people running around all the time. They love being skinny, right? White people wake up at, like, 5 a.m. They run 18 miles in Central Park. And then they run over to Whole Foods and spend like $400 on flax seeds, right? You know? But then Hispanic people, being fat is sort of cool, right? Like, obesity is in. Like, diabetes. Diabetes is like an aphrodisiac to the Puerto Ricans, you know what I'm saying? Like, nothing will give a Puerto Rican man a stiffy like a cankle. And I go to a gym in Harlem. And let me tell you, white people, that is no Equinox, okay? Because I take a cycling class with a woman there, and she's out of breath just mounting the bike. It's really interesting. I'll leave you guys with this. There are a lot of sad things going on in the world right now. You know, just really awful things. We've got terrorism happening, right? ISIS. We got Ebola in the city, you know? Just gun violence in schools as well with children. I mean, it's just, it's sad and it's tragic. Do you know what else is sad and tragic? What's that? Fat girls with small tits. Right? Because what do you do with that? Because a fat girl that gets in play if she got them fat girl titties, right? But if she doesn't have that, it's like three strikes, you're out. Being fat takes up two whole strikes. All right, thank you so much. I'm Spleek Gordon.
So, do you guys want to hear a funny joke?
Oh, God.
I already told mine. So. All
right. So there's two guys. They decide to have a brick throwing contest, okay? So, one guy throws his brick, and it goes like 100 feet up in the air. The next guy throws his brick, and it never comes down! Get it? Never comes down? No, yeah. All right, well, anyway. Okay, well, let me tell you a different joke.
I know that joke
I was telling you about, the two guys on the plane?
The monkey and the cigar.
Yeah, the monkey and the cigar.
Yes.
Okay, I'll just tell it again. So, two guys on a plane fighting. Well, but they weren't fighting. Hold on. Two guys on a plane. One smoking a cigar. One has a monkey in his lap. The guy with the monkey in his lap gets really annoyed at the cigar smoker. Finally says, "Sir, that cigar really stinks. Can you please put it out?" And the guy says, "Oh, yes, I'll put my cigar out if you shut your little yappy monkey up." So the guy with the monkey gets really offended, and he's like, "Look, my monkey is the sweetest, cutest animal. Do not tell my monkey to shut up." So they get in this big fight. The pilot comes out of the cockpit. It's like, "Both you guys need to shut up. I can hear you all the way from the cockpit, and I am not going to come out here again. If you don't shut your monkey up, and if you don't stop smoking your cigar, I'm throwing both of them out the window." So the guy with the monkey says, "But his cigar stinks. But the monkey's really loud." Oh, I warned you. The pilot takes the cigar, takes the monkey, throws both out the window. They both, all the guys, jump over to the window. And guess what they see? On the wing of the plane. The monkey. Sitting on the wing of the plane. And guess what was in the monkey's mouth?
Cigar.
No, the brick!
Wow.
Sorry, I told her in the wrong order before. I haven't really told that joke since I was probably in third grade.
So. Wow.
Hey, keep it going for Shablique, man. She did awesome. As a white guy who's dating an Asian girl, I'm sorry. You know? I know all you out there in podcast land can't see her, but she's cute. She's almost as cute as an Asian girl. You know what I mean? Like, I would almost cheat. You know, I'm going to cheat on my Asian girlfriend with her if I get the chance. But I'll say it. It's a first podcast. There might not be enough people to where she'll find out about it listening. You know, so I think I'm good. I think I'm in the clear. Good. Actually, no. I'm not. I'm not gonna do it though, because you had me at. I want to date a white guy with an Asian girlfriend, but you lost me, and I have no gag reflex. Right? Is any woman that leads with "I have no gag reflex" in my experience always ends up being a dude. That's right. Always a dude. You know the old saying, right? You know, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me like 5-6 times, and that's way too many dudes to, you know what I mean, get back in the bathroom after a podcast. So I'm not going to do that. Today's not going like Wednesday and Thursday. Yeah, it's not gonna happen. A lot of people like have been talking about catcalling because of that video that's gone viral, you know, and like it comes up a lot, like work online, that kind of thing. And I've noticed guys tend to trivialize it a lot. Like a lot of friends of mine, they tend to take the stance of oh, it's not that big a deal. They'll be like, well, you know, women getting told that they look good by guys, that's a glasses half full kind of problem. And it's like, yeah, it is if the guy telling you look good is a good looking guy. Yeah. Most of the time, that's not the case. Okay, Brad Pitt and Denzel Washington are not catcalling right now. I live uptown. It's usually dudes that look more like Forrest Whitaker without the talent or notoriety or job. Just lazy eyes and bad hygiene, you know? That's, you know, I think it'd be bad. I think it'd be bad for guys if the roles were reversed. Because guys always picture them getting catcalled by the women that they would catcall. That's not how it's going to go. It's going to be the same caliber of women. I think it would suck. It'd be cool for the first couple days just hearing what kind of clever euphemisms they can think of for my dick, right? That'd be fun. But after a while, it'd be like, wait a minute, how come only women that look like Rosie O'Donnell or like the grown-up girl from Precious want to like sprinkle some magic ass on my little vanilla bean stock and watch it grow, whoa, whoa, right? Why can't I get a cat collar in my own weight class? This is bullshit. That's why, you know, this has made me start thinking. I am going to start catcalling. I catcall now, but I only catcall the ugly ones. That's right. Because who does catcalling really hurt? I mean, does it hurt the good-looking women getting catcalled? I mean, it offends them. It bothers them. But does it hurt them more or the ugly girl right behind them that gets nothing every time? That sucks. So I catcall the ugly ones, just like Christ used to do. You know what I'm saying? Back when him and the apostles used to stand around Nazareth using their EBT cards to buy you know, Gatorade and turn it into like Hennessy or something. You know? And yes, I am, of course, talking about black Jesus because, you know, white Jesus doesn't catcall. White people don't catcall. We don't catcall women. No, we quietly follow them home. You know what I mean? But no, so I'm gonna catcall the ugly ones. But I'm not going to yell some of the degrading things. I'm not going to yell like, oh, shorty, you've got a fat ass. I'm going to say like, shorty, you've got a thin to medium size ass because by golly, the diet's been working. You're about to get a job, guy with a job. That's right. About to get a guy with a job. But no, man, you're talking about terrorism. I've been thinking a lot about ISIS and stuff because we're dumping people back in Iraq again. I mean, not just advisors, not just the 7,000 advisors or whatever that we had there. People that we're actually saying are going into combat. We're saying we got to have them back there now because ISIS is beheading people and doing all that. And I think that we should be bombing ISIS. I think that we should be bombing them right now. But see, I think we should be a little bit smarter than we used to do it, right? We should only use bombs that are big enough to blow up the ISIS insurgents and not all the weapons that we bought them last year to fight al-Assad. You know what I'm saying? We pay good money for that stuff. That way, the next time we want to give weapons to a bunch of armed militants that we don't really know much about, we can lease it out like a Manhattan slumlord. You know, fight smarter, not harder. That's what I say. If we are going to buy them new stuff, let's just make them like bright pink or red or something so they're easy to see with drones and stuff, you know? How about just make it something that it blows up by itself after a year when we decide that they're bad? Or, we could do that. Or let's use all the weapons that we have in our country, not just... Let's have Apple design the rifles, right? That way, after like a year, 2 years or whatever, they got to come back and they got to be like, no work. My AK-47, no turn on. The screen's broken, you know? And we got to be like, oh, that's because that's the AK-47 4S. We don't even have that anymore. You gotta order a 6. That should be here in like a couple weeks or something. And then when they're sitting around without weapons, we use the drones to blow up them and every man, woman, and child in their village and call them terrorists under a false flag operation. A method tried and true, sure. But we also make a reality TV show about the trucker that delivered the drone parts to the place, right? And we call it... Imperial Death Machine from the Sky Truckers, and we use the money to buy cheeseburgers for every single one of us. It'll be the most American thing we've ever done. It'll be awesome. See, both fascism and socialism, I feel, communism could work as a system as long as I was the guy twirling the mustache. You know what I'm saying? Because I got good ideas. I do. Like education. Here's something I think we should do different with education. Every kid in America, when they turn 8, should have to pick their own name. No, they should, and it stays the same until they're like in their 20s. They can't change it until then. That way, when your kid's about to go off to college, you can look at him and be like, son, daughter, you know, whatever you have, right? You can be like, I know that you think it's a good idea to run up $100,000 in student loan debts to become a theater major now, but we don't always appreciate our long-term decisions later, do we, Green Ranger? No, we don't. No, we don't. Hey, I'm Jake Beverly. That's my time. Thank you.
It's weird. My life is like completely devoid of pets or animals or whatever.
You've never had a pet?
I've had fish. Which don't count as pets. They don't. No. They count as living things that you probably shouldn't just let die.
So are plants.
Well, yeah, that's the same thing. They're really more decorative than companions. Yeah. That's kind of how I see it. Although it was very sad when my fish died.
How long did you have them?
I don't remember. They weren't super long, but I had those little like beta fighting fish.
You had fighting fish?
What? Yeah, like you know those little Japanese. They're like red or blue or something, and you can't really put them in a tank with other fish, otherwise they'll fight each other and kill each other. I had one of those, and it was the only pet I ever had. So
did you really love it? Because you haven't even told us its name yet. You just keep calling it.
I forgot what I called it.
Oh my god.
That's sad.
That's why it's a fish, and I'm not telling you the story of like, oh, the first dog I ever had died, and it was I never had a dog. I never had dogs or cats. I don't have them now. It's weird. It's not by like some personal choice of like, I hate animals. They can all go to hell.
Are you allergic?
No.
There's nothing preventing you from getting an animal.
Outside of the cost of having one, that no. That's really it. I'm just probably more selfish and like going out and buying, not things, because I don't really have a lot of materials, but basically, you know, just go out and hang out with people and spend money doing that. Then like, oh, insert dog name here. I wasn't gonna go down that road. All right. Yeah. That's like a stereotypical dog name, man.
Fluffy.
That's for cats. What if we're keeping animals down by calling them Fido or Rex, man? What if it's like the whole thing with the Washington Redskins, but Fido is for dogs?
Whoa.
I know it's a weird tangent, but yeah. What if? What if? Just think for like a half second. What if?
What do you think dogs call you? Like if you have a dog.
Ooh,
or
that's deep, man.
Yeah, right. Why was it?
You must be a scientist.
Wow. The worst kind of just sitting around, don't do work, and think about this stuff.
Just like, ooh.
What's my cat think about me?
Okay, so there's only been one time in my life when I genuinely felt like I was going to die. I was 6 years old, and it sounds like I'm trying to be funny, but this is when I started having a heightened awareness of death. I think it's because my mom made me watch that movie Karina Karina with her. And if no one's seen it, it's with Whoopi Goldberg, and it's about this little girl. Her mom dies. She's so depressed. And around this time, I would sit up at night crying because I was afraid of what would happen if my mom died. So I was aware that death was a thing that I had to be afraid of. I was over my best friend Erin's house. She lived a few blocks away. It was summer. And we would do typical 90s kids things. So we would be outside climbing trees and spying on neighbors and trespassing. And it was starting to get dark. We had climbed her tree. We would do this a lot. There was a really tall tree in the front of her house. We'd bring a notebook and binoculars, and we'd spy on her neighbors and write down observations like, Mr. Thompson's washing his car right now. I wonder what he's going to do after. So this was the extent of our summers together. And it had started to get dark. It was August, so it was getting a little chilly. And Erin said, we were high up in the tree. She said, do you want to go inside? I'm getting a little cold. I said, okay. She climbed down first, and I was still climbing above her, and I heard her jump down to the ground, scream, and then take off towards our house. And I knew I had to get down to the bottom of the tree, but I had no idea what I was going to see when I got down there. So I got down to the bottom, I turned around, and it was very dark. I see a shadowy shadowy figure of a dog, and he's growling. It's a really big, dark dog. And I take off towards Erin's porch where she ran. She, I don't know if it was instinct or she just didn't like me hanging around her that much, but she went in her house, she closed her front door, and she was already in her living room window watching to see how it would unfold for me. So I went up her porch stairs, and I remember backing up. There was nowhere else to go. I was at the door, and the dog was growling at me with his teeth out. And I remember at 6 years old distinctively thinking to myself, this is it, Danielle. This is how you're going to die. And a few seconds later, Erin's older sister, Hallie, opened up the door and she yelled, Nala! It's Nala from down the street! And all of a sudden, the dog starts wagging its tail and jumping up and licking her. And in that moment, I knew I had a new lease on life.
Guys, I'm really thankful about one thing.
Okay.
It's Thanksgiving, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So let's be thankful. Well, I'm really thankful that the hooker in my apartment building finally moved out.
Okay.
We had a hooker in our apartment building?
You didn't know that?
I didn't.
Well, don't you guys remember the screams?
Oh, I thought somebody was getting murdered.
I just assumed loud sex.
Well, you would have assumed correctly, my friend.
Okay. I didn't realize it was a hook. It was the screams of a hooker.
That was money scream sex.
No, but one night you guys weren't home, and it was the first time I ever heard it after I moved into your place, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Well, now it's our place, of course, under the blanket fort. Yeah. But anyway, so I'm like just dozing off, and all of a sudden I hear this like crazy screaming, like somebody is getting not only their fingers cut off, but their legs and their arms and their necks. I don't know what.
Oh, I saw that episode of American Horror Story, too. That was great.
Not really into torture porn.
So, but I heard this couple. So, you know, this goes on for, you know, like I come out of my apartment. I'm like, what should I do? I'm like pacing. I'm like, do I call the police? What do I do? So, you know, like I open my door really quietly and I bring a knife with me and I tiptoe out into the hallway. And it's just going on and on. I was like, no one could be getting killed this long.
Death comes faster than this.
All right. Listen, at some point, guy, just give up.
I figured it out. We had a screamer on our hands, you know.
Yeah.
She's a screamer. So next day, I see our neighbor across the hall, and she says, oh, did you hear that last night? I'm like, yes.
Did you initiate? Did you just look?
Did you give her a
look?
Well,
it was kind of like, you know, we both walk out at the same time.
Oh, God.
Lock stare.
Oh, God. Because
we both knew. Like, oh, God. You know, it just happened last night.
Hey, man. Sorry.
Kept us, both of us, away.
There's no way you didn't. If you pretend that you didn't hear that.
Exactly.
She would just be like, look, social contract and everything, I get it, but you don't have to.
Right.
The awkwardness is going to kill you. Just let it out.
Exactly. Yeah. So she goes, well, you know about her, right? The one in 16L? 16L?
Oh, 16L.
Okay.
Write it down.
16L. Don't write it down.
No, I'm not writing it down.
She doesn't live there anymore.
Oh. Okay.
Anyway.
I don't want part of this anyway.
I was like, no, what do you mean? She's a prostitute. I was like, what? I live in a building with a prostitute? That's actually kind of cool. So anyway, over time, like, I finally see this girl.
Okay.
I finally see her. And, you know, she's kind of attractive, you know, whatever. She's not, like, gorgeous, but she's like, you know, she was really thankful to me because I held the elevator for her.
Okay.
So ever since then, she was, like, chatty, chatty, chat.
Oh, my God. This is just,
she
like,
loves
pretty, this is like Pretty Woman. This is amazing.
Yeah.
Best friends with the building's prostitute.
Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just Nightwalker.
I was gonna say courtesan.
Lady of the evening.
Love.
Maybe what I noticed was kind of interesting is that, you know, so for a while there I didn't have a day job. I noticed these guys, like carpenter kind of guys, like construction worker type guys, they would come into the apartment building holding flowers.
Oh, God.
At around, you know, 12, 1 o'clock.
Oh, God.
Almost every day. And they, I, you know, like, get into the elevator with me. We go up my floor. 16th
oh my
floor.
God, they're afternoon hooking.
Yeah.
Afternoon hooking.
So they're just leaving the job site early. Just
yeah.
Get, oh
no,
my
taking
God.
Their lunch
yeah,
break.
Yeah, I'm going to get lunch. I'm going to have a sandwich and I'm just going to do it.
Wow.
I've never wanted to be a construction worker war.
But what I thought was interesting is they always brought her flowers. So that must be like her thing. Like, bring me flowers and then I'll scream. I don't know.
Wow. That's like Jamie Lee Curtis in Trading Places.
Oh, yeah.
He the guy who brought her flowers.
She's a nice girl, though. I like her.
Underneath this boogie beat, designed to make you tap your feet, there's a subtle hint of mystery. Put your folks' minds at ease. They won't extrapolate that the song makes you masturbate.
What?
We're singing about sex, mama. S-E-X. A photoracky sack about sex, mama. S-E-X is the best. We fool you with our cutesy words. A toot, a toot, a tootie attitude. And harmonies we sing like birds. Lollipop, lollipop, oh lolly lolly. It's not candy we want to lick. We want to lick your dick.
Your dick.
We're singing about sex, mama. S-E-X. A photoracky sack about sex, mama. S-E-X is the best. Scrub me, mama. Eight to the bar. Beat me, daddy. Eight to the bar. Get busy as a bee. Eight to the bar. Balls and tits. Dicks and clits. We're singing about sex, mama. S-E-X. A photoracky sack about sex, mama. S-E-X is the best. Ooh, ah, grunt and moan. I'll scream for joy if you want a bone. Dicks and cunts and balls and clits. I'll lick your taint if you suck my tits. This song has lost all class. Oh well, let's fuck in the ass. Yes, we're singing about sex, mama. S-E-X. A photoracky sack about sex, mama. S-E-X is the best. Sex, mama. S-E-X. A photoracky sack about sex, mama. S-E-X is the B-E-S-T.
Best Food Iraqi Sake.
So, you know what's really creepy? I was cleaning out my stuff.
Okay.
And I had a real dilemma. Like, honest to God dilemma. I'm going through my stuff and I found my great uncle's, like, prayer card they give you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When somebody dies, mm-hmm. like, your memento.
Oh, yeah.
A memento from a funeral? Wait, hold on. Did you just call it a memento?
What else is it?
No, that's kind of what it is.
It's got a little prayer on it.
It's a little memento. I'm just thinking of like, oh, I got somebody a shot glass when I went to Vegas or something. It's like a little...
That's so much worse if you give out... No, my funeral's going to give out shot glasses. That's brilliant.
You better die of alcohol-related death.
All right, can you please get to
this? Oh, yeah. So I'm like getting rid of it. And like I'm purging stuff. Like I'm really big. I have like tons of boxes of just crap that I'm trying to get rid of. And I stood there and it took me the longest time to decide. Do I keep it? Do I throw it away? What do? Do I put it back in the box? Like what's yes. like birthday cards? You have a year.
Does it have like prayer hands on it? Is it that kind
it's
of
It's got a picture
card?
Of Jesus. It's got a picture of Jesus on the front.
Ooh, that's hard to throw away.
It is.
Yeah. You have to throw it away face down.
It's yes. a beatific. It's a beatific Jesus. But
right.
But you know what's in there. Yeah. I had no idea.
Has,
what
like gold inlay and stuff.
Yeah. I was thinking about cashing it, but there's not enough on it. But yeah, it's
you get like less than a penny.
It's fine. I get some, but I honestly couldn't get rid of it.
Tim, I don't think it's real gold.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. So
it could be. He's an ostentatious guy.
just a panhandler.
So what'd you do? What'd you do?
I put it back in the box. I had a serious problem throwing away my stereo. I had to bring it to the dump, and I like hand to God, I whispered to it as I left. I'm like,
I'm sorry.
No, I said you're gonna be something better. I swear to God, you're gonna be fine. And I left. I drove away. I couldn't look in the mirror. I had a real problem. The stereo didn't even work. You plug it in, nothing happens. It's dead. There's no repair.
There's something to it. I mean, you know.
Just attach emotional attributes to inanimate objects.
Yeah.
Did the stereo work at one point?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love that stereo.
Oh, that's why.
With all my heart. I loved it. I played so many of my favorite songs.
Okay. I actually have a magic mirror.
A magic mirror?
Explain.
Well, when I lived in Florida, I lived in this apartment building, and I found this mirror by the dumpster.
Okay.
And it was kind of nice. So I took it in and cleaned it up. And I swear, I brought it to New York with me because I swear every time I look in it, I feel like I look better.
Really?
It's yeah. Like,
that's your mirror.
Yeah. It's like, a magic mirror.
Huh. That's weird. I probably have stuff that I'm like crazy sentimental about. I just haven't had to throw it away yet, so I don't know.
Right? You got to purge, and then it's very jarring.
The last time I purged a lot of stuff was when I moved, and all I really threw away was just tons and tons of papers and like notebooks and stuff from college courses. And
you threw yours away?
No, I didn't throw away the textbooks and some notebooks. I kept all the stuff from my major.
Oh, you kept all the chem stuff. Okay, good.
Kept all the chem and math stuff. I didn't throw that away. That's buried somewhere. I don't know where.
Too. I have like
I
a
don't
stack.
Know. Yeah, I have like a crate, one of those like, yeah. you know, plastic.
Like under the bed storage, guys?
Yeah. Like yeah. container store.
Yeah.
Full of my papers from college
and
grad school. I don't know what to do with them. What do you do with those?
You hold on to it until one day you have to throw it away, and then you weep silently internally.
And you promise it, like, you'll be better someday. I swear to God, you'll be better someday.
And that is why I will always love my son. Now, Thomas's college roommate and fraternity brother Albert will share some fond memories that they made together.
Shit. I mean, damn. Lay's potato chips. I mean, Thomas Tuttle. Let me crack an egg of knowledge on your foreheads about Thomas. He was a bro unlike any other. A bro of convictions. A dude of his bitchin' word. I remember where I was when I heard that he drowned in that hot tub with a roll of butcher paper and a police horse. Bruce of Stalin, a Russian exchange donor, was loafing on the couch, rolling a blunt, watching SpongeBob, when Rando came in, looking like someone just stole his car. He told us and the room just died.
Son.
Shit, sorry, I mean, we all got really sad. Brotato was our bro. He wore the letters proudly, and he was the best pledge master we ever had. Dude had all the frosh walking around with pine cones in their pants for Hell Week. Can you imagine that? That's some creative shit right there. Without him, we would have just made the frosh drink a couple of handles of Jim Beam and dance until we all got bored. He was a rock.
Son.
And there was that time we broke into the dining hall and covered ourselves in nacho cheese and did whippets. Rando, you were there. Remember how Brotato started humping the fryer later? That's how he got his name, by the way. Tongue out, humping that deep fryer like it owed him money. Shit, halcyon days, man.
Son, this is a funeral. For God's sake, have some respect.
Totally, I got you, bro. He streaked the whole assembly of the Greek council when they had Maya Angelou give a speech. He kept yelling, I knew why the uncaged dong sings. He was literate as fuck. You are not going to get that kind of naked knowledge bomb from any other comm major. I guarantee it. Shit.
This is hardly appropriate. For God's sakes, this is my son's funeral, and you're telling these horrible stories. What is wrong with you? What kind of an imbecile thinks that his family and friends, who are in mourning, want to hear this? I can't let you embarrass my son any further and upset my wife. Now, please sit down.
No, dude, it's all good. I was just getting to the part that really shows his legacy and what an amazing bro he was. So the best time I had with him was when he straight up fucked the shit out of that math building. Dude pried loose a brick from the side of that math annex and just shoved his junk in there. We rolled up on him, we're all like, bro, what the fuck are you doing? And he's just like, Calcutta's gonna fuck me, I'm gonna fuck math right back. So he finishes, and me, him, Rando, and Bro Sustan have to book it off campus, because the 5-0 are starting to get calls. So we hid in the bushes for like 3 hours. And the whole time, Bro Tato was smiling, because he knew no professor was gonna get him down. Shit. I'm gonna miss you, Bro Tato. No homo.
Just get the fuck out.
Alright, guys. Check this out.
You know that lady downstairs? The one who likes to bang on the ceiling.
Oh, yeah, yeah. God,
so that. When you guys weren't home the other day, I was working out in our apartment, like in the living room, and all of a sudden I'm in the middle of my workout and I hear this bang on our front door. So I go over and it's this little lady who's like, she's like my height, you know, short, and she's probably like, I don't know, 60, 70 years old or something. And she says, excuse me, are you the one in here? I don't know what kind of accent I'm doing.
Yeah, I was confused.
She was German?
I'm going to say Polish?
I don't know what she was.
She's a little bit of Dracula?
She...
That's all I heard. I just heard
Dracula. I'm not very good at accents sometimes.
It's a great accent.
Anyway, she was like, you're the one making the noise? And I was like, oh, I'm really sorry. I was just working out, you know, like... I mean, I know it's only for like 45 minutes. Is it okay? Do you mind if I just finish? And she was like, I can't believe you're the one making that noise. You're so tiny. I still don't know what kind of accent I'm doing.
That's all. Here's Dracula. Keep going. You're the one making the noise.
You're the one who makes the noise. So... I was like, yeah. Well, I'm like jumping. You know, I'm like, you know, I was like jumping and, you know, doing jumping jacks, whatever. I can't believe you're the one who makes the noise.
Romanian gypsy.
That's it.
She's Romanian. She was Romanian.
She was Romanian gypsy.
She was.
That's what that's why I kept hearing Dracula.
That's right. I forgot.
Did she put like a hex on you or something?
Yeah. No, I don't. Maybe.
Did she do one of the? Did she do with the pinky and the pinky and the index finger?
You mean the devil sign?
Yeah, this is the Maloik.
What is it?
The Maloik.
Maloik?
The evil eye, the Maloik.
The Maloik.
Yeah.
Did you get that from the downstairs lady?
No. I mean, she was like, oh, I'm so sorry. Yes, please. Work out as much as you like. Oh, you're so tiny.
Okay, now that's Dracula.
Yeah.
It was you.
Oh,
So she leaves.
Yeah,
okay? Next day, working out. Bang, 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 bang. Bang, 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 bang.
That sounds like her.
But she's... I could hear her, like really yelling, really yelling. So I'm like, whoa. So I get a knock on the door. It's a super.
Oh, God.
Super's like, I've been getting some complaints from your downstairs neighbor. I was like, oh, really? Really? Because she's been banging on my ceiling. Can I complain?
You don't complain against Dracula, dude.
Yeah, you don't want. Or a Romanian gypsy.
Yeah.
Either.
It could be either way, yeah.
She really was Romanian, actually. Yeah.
She's
Romanian.
Here's the question. If we can figure out if she's Romanian gypsy or Dracula, did she try to come in the apartment?
Did she?
She did. She invited me into her apartment because then after the super came, I went downstairs to apologize, and she invited me into her apartment.
Yeah, but I think they can let you. You can go into Castle Dracula whenever you want, but he can't come into your house unless you invite him.
Yeah,
so she did not let her in. No.
Yeah, no, don't ever let her in, just in case she's a vampire.
Ooh. Windows blacked out.
No, I don't remember. I wasn't thinking she was a vampire.
Did you see a crystal ball on the table?
Was her son the Wolfman?
No, but she did not have a bed.
Oh,
Point Dracula. Point Dracula. Yeah, okay. Yep, I got a point for Dracula.
She hardly had anything in her apartment. She just had like a bunch of like old pictures.
2 points, Dracula.
Like these frames with like gold filigree.
Oh, yeah.
And Romanian dance music.
I can go either way. You know what? Point each.
Point, yeah. Point each.
Point each. So we're 3-1 Dracula. You got anything else you can give us on her? Was she unusually pale?
She was very, very pale.
Eastern European. Hold on. Right,
point each.
But what I just didn't get is like when I'd be there in her face, she'd be like, no, 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 it's okay. Do whatever you want to do. But then as soon as I start doing what I want to do, bang, 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 bang.
Maybe she had the bloodlust. She just like sensed all the blood and she was just like, I want that blood.
Wow.
So we live above a Dracula.
Maybe. Does she have any mirrors?
Oh.
She's not.
Oh.
Dracula. Yeah, it was Dracula. Dracula. 5 points, Dracula. Yep.
Dracula's solved. We're done.
Wow. What are the terms of release? Because I don't want to live above a Dracula. I'm really, honest
to
God, nervous.
We're going to have to go take a look at that. let's comb through that one with a fine tooth comb. Whoops.
The sentence was so clumsy.
It was.
The Dracula's got to him now.
Yeah.
I'm going to stand by you.
Well, what was really weird was when she, like, bit my neck.
Okay, now you're just
Now you're just we saw you outside in the sun today. Okay, don't pull that crap.
I'm just kidding.
You didn't sparkle or nothing.
Stop it.
God, don't! I'm really scared of Draculas.
Just Draculas or all vampires?
I call all Draculas vampires. All vampires are Draculas.
Racist.
All right, fine. You know what? Yep, that's it. That's my racist point. All vampires are Draculas.
Wow. We're going to get so many letters.
And you're criticizing me for naming my dog Blackie.
No, I was doing that.
I was criticizing you for throwing eggs at Dominicans.
We're none of us are racist.
Under the Blanket Fort was written and performed by Kay Rose, Chris Musto, and Tim Short. The Honeymooner sketch and the song Talking About Sex were written and performed by Kay Rose. The Superman Catcher and Eulogy sketches were written and performed by Tim Short and Chris Musto. Stand-up was performed by Shabli Quarterman, at Shabli Q on Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram, and Jake Vevra. You can hear him on the Idiots on Parade podcast or on Twitter and Facebook, at Jake Vevra. Too Drunk to Care was performed by Amelita Lijek. You can find her on Twitter at Amelita. That's 4 A's, M-E-L-I-T-A. The storytelling segment was written and performed by Danielle Crace. You can find her on Twitter at Danielle Crace. Water Drop and Sea was performed by Justin Freidus, who is too cool to have an Instagram. The opening song, Computer, was written and performed by State Shirt. Find out more about this amazing band on their website, stateshirt.com. The closing song, the thing you're listening to right now, is Seas of Mars by Jazar. Find out more about this particularly rad individual on soundcloud.com/JAHZZAR. Both songs used under Creative Commons.